other their intended purpose, which is, I mean, you know, interior preservation. And so using, you know, putting them out in the environment, putting them out in a lawn where the chemicals can leach over to your neighbors, et cetera. It already is a violation of federal law, but the thought was that if we could just have a local ordinance matching that, that it would just make it kind of easier for us and the public to enforce. So I think that's something I'd be prepared to go ahead and get in writing.
I would ask Mr. Mueller, there's nothing is, that covers that on the existing codes, is it?
Not in zoning or the planning, or the property maintenance code. I don't believe in the city code of ordinances. I don't recall seeing anything in that either. It's not a planning and zoning. Who's to enforce it needs to kind of have an input on that, but I have no idea who that's intended to be at this point.
Thank you.
Well, my sense is that a local ordinance would just give, you know, citizens kind of a little more legal recourse and a little more ability to follow up on things themselves. Is that fair to say?
Mm-hmm. Like change the oil of your car.
Based on Mr. Mueller's comments, I was thinking of who would enforce it, how it would be reported, of course, to City Hall. Which department would enforce it? And I guess that's to be determined.
I'm sorry, Mayor. I said it would almost have to be planning. It's going to be on a property related.
Yeah, code violation.
Mm-hmm. Seems like it.
Someone could just fill out the form.
Environmental of the allegation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what I would think.
I hesitate to ask, but I don't know if it's covered by public health law.
It would seem to me it would kind of
maybe environmental inspector from the public health department. I'll be glad to check on that.
Yeah, okay.
That'd be great.
Do you think we could get maybe a report and recommendations from you on how best to address this?
From public health?
Recommendations for how best we could address this locally.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Uh-huh. Is that fair?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
There was consensus. Okay. So we could move.
I'll be all for it.
And as long as we're on the issue of code enforcement, we've looked at you know, some different standards for rental property inspection. We specifically looked at an ordinance out of West Lafayette, and there's also been discussion of a renter's bill of rights.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I think everybody's had time to review that, including our staff. Would it be okay for us to hear from our planning director? If you can you give us your thoughts on that? I know you have some.
I don't have my notes with me, but I'll go over my recollection the best I can. Mm-hmm. The rental program itself, the proposal or the suggestion was moving to an annual or a 2-year up to a 5-year span, depending upon any violations that we noted at that specific structure. The costs were a lot up front plus per unit, but then you only had to have that payment based on it, whether you were on a 2-year or 3 or 5 year cycle. I have some reservation with that. I'm not opposed to a 1-year sweep by any means, but I think we do a far, from our research, there are very few communities in the state or nation that does every time the lease is up, we do a walkthrough. What we've noticed through some of the property owners is that turnover has increased over the past 2 years due to the economy. Whether they, and most of those are not at the owner's wish or that the tenant's wish. They're getting forced out. They're not making their payments, so they're being evicted. We've seen a lot more internal damage, not necessarily property maintenance code violations, but lack of care moving out by the tenants or by the owners moving people out. Those wouldn't be seen if we go to a 2 year, 5 year process. So that was a strong concern of ours. One of the things there's a couple of things that we really liked, and that is coming up with a sticker where when we do an inspection, we do post both the occupancy and when it was inspected. And there were a couple other, there was three things specific I remember. The sticker was the main one that we really liked. Mm-hmm. Going to an annual review, we liked, but not as the only for inspection. I think we would be doing a disservice to the tenants. Struggle with the, if you're a good landlord, you get longer, and if you're a bad landlord, you get more reviews. It's hard to be subjective. The subjectivity of that is the biggest question of mine on the enforcement, being the one responsible for who makes that call. Spoke with the community, but the individual that I had some additional follow-up questions, and we're still working those out. So I don't have all of my answers answered, I guess, is the best way to put it. But we do plan on implementing the sticker program for sure. And Mr. Engel is meeting tomorrow, I believe. He's been asked to meet with a local, there's a landlord association, have asked him to come tomorrow to do a small presentation, which I think is great, and it's a wonderful thing we should do more of. So I'm looking for positive feedback on that as well. The Bill of Rights, rental rights, landlord, the state has a Landlord-Tenant Act. State, other authorities enforce that, not the city. I haven't done much research on that, honestly, to see what level the city wants to have involvement. In the past, administration's been, leave it with the authority that KRS indicates it with. And I did ask Commissioner Walter to have a meeting to get his thoughts on some of these changes, and we didn't discuss that one that day. I apologize. I'm happy to answer any questions you have, but that's my recollection of kind of where we're at. I'm hoping Robbie will come back with some information from our meeting tomorrow, from his meeting tomorrow also.
I just got a real quick question, if I may, man. Do we know what communities like Lexington and Louisville are doing for their rental inspections or anything like that?
Yes, but it's in my notes. I can provide a written report to
sure,
you all.
That would be
happy to do that on the research we've done and the breakdown. But to my knowledge, I haven't found anyone else who does it the way we do it. Most agencies indicate that's too much. They couldn't handle that load. And I didn't see in the submittal any safeguard to prevent. One of the concerns I have heard is that there's houses fall through the cracks, or there are units may fall through the cracks. I didn't see that a solution to that in the other proposals either. And my discussions with them, sometimes that happens. They fall through the cracks. But just a better education, spending money on that education side, I think would help. We do run an ad in the paper. We've done it since 1998, I think. It's a very short ad, but it is in the rental section, letting people know they're looking for rentals. That's a requirement. But I think that we haven't changed that wording. We haven't emphasized that other than that small amount, and I think we could do a better job of that, actually.
Do you guys also cover for businesses, like when businesses that rent space?
None, not at all. Been discussed, feels like 3 years ago, very briefly, but it never went anywhere. It was strictly for residential dwellings, not, but we don't inspect hotels, mm-hmm. units, we don't inspect commercial rentals. Can we? Yes. Do we have codes on that? Yes. Mm-hmm. But we've never, we don't have that program, and I haven't seen, haven't found in my research that others do that either. But there, I'm sure there's somebody out there that may.
Mm-hmm. Public health inspects the hotels, motels.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Is that an annual basis, I take it? Or
At least annually and upon complaint.
Okay.
Okay, Commissioner. If I could, and because I suggested this in the first place, and Gary did follow up after he reviewed the ordinance and asked me, you know, what my motivation was essentially in suggesting this, and I just told him the same thing that I've said, you know, when I brought it to the commission, which is that my hope is that this would increase, actually increase both inspections and compliance, or at least increase inspections of troubled properties and compliance. If you know, if the facts on the ground are as Gary says, that that the schedule, that the 1-5 year schedule, as opposed to in between renters, would actually decrease the inspections, then for my part, that's something I'm happy to walk away from. I think the thing that really increases compliance are the stickers.
Yeah, I agree.
Mm-hmm. Obviously. I do have a question about how that would work. So let's say we inspect rental properties every 2 years, and you know, you inspect my rental property, I pass, I get a sticker that goes on the front door that says this property has been certified safe by the City of Frankfort from 2012, you know, January 2012 through December 2013. Then everybody knows that my rental property has been inspected mm-hmm. by the city, even passerby on the street, and they also can tell, you know, any prospective renters can tell by looking at the sticker whether or not I'm currently in compliance, because all I have to do is check the current date versus the dates on the sticker.
Mm-hmm.
If the inspections and the stickers are based on whether or not tenants are moving out, then how can somebody look at this, you know, so let's say, you know, I'm renting to Gippy, he moves out and I rent to Katie, and I don't tell you all, I don't get a new inspection, I just keep the same old sticker on my window. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm getting at? I mean, how can Katie moves out and Michael wants to move in, and he comes, how can Michael tell by looking at the sticker on the window whether or not I actually got the inspection that I was supposed to? Does that make, do you see what I'm asking?
Yes, that was a concern of mm-hmm. ours on a strictly just an annual basis or every 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
Because if someone moves out and leaves it in worse condition, puts holes in the walls,
sure.
makes things unsafe, we wouldn't be required to go back.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas now, we are required to go back if a tenant moves in and they call us, we can say, nope, we didn't do an inspection before you moved in, so we need to do a follow-up, the way it is today.
Mm-hmm.
And we can cite that owner for all those issues. Mm-hmm. It's harder for me to do it the other opposite way. Meaning, you have a 2-year blanket, and we're going to say it's okay, regardless of what happens between now and 2 years from now.
Sure.
What I would like to do, the way I think it would work the easiest, and hopefully the end result is what we're shooting for, is do the program the way we have it now, but any rental unit that we have not inspected within the 12-month period, we schedule an inspection. So if the same tenant lives there for 3 years, we've never seen that building for 3 years, mm-hmm. that tenant space. They lived, I mean, we have some that have lived there for a long time,
mm-hmm.
and we haven't been in that unit for a long time. Doesn't mean that's wrong, but it's a way to help, one, avoid any of the fall through the cracks, and two, it just reassures those tenants that their structure is safe, their landlord is doing everything that they need to be doing as a minimum standard. And that way, every year, every 12-month period, we would look at every unit at least once. I like that process because we know the number of units, and we have a really good idea of how many units we have based on the garbage new program we just did. We're waiting to get the scanners that they have. Eventually, they'll have a GIS layer showing how many cans every structure has in town. Then we can compare that with our notes. If our unit, if we say this is just a one single unit, but they got four cans,
mm-hmm. right?
There's a problem here, or missing something, or a, you know what I mean? We are taking that initiative to do that cross reference. I just have to have the data from Public Works. Mm-hmm. It's not available yet. So as soon as that's done, that's the first thing on my list to do, is cross reference our rentals versus the number of cans that was issued per site, and we'll find which ones we're missing, which will be a huge improvement. What I would like to do moving forward is get an inspection every time a tenant turns over. Any unit that we had not inspected in 12 months, we'll call and schedule an inspection. Walk through, everything's fine. That's how I see us moving forward. With the sticker, it would indicate the occupancy, when it was inspected, and if you have any concerns or questions, just call us at any given time. It's not a valid from here forward forever. It's just lets the person know the last time we were there. Does that make sense? That's the way I see the sticker, which is more than what we have now.
Right.
I'm amenable to other suggestions by all means, but that's what I've discussed and I've processed in my brain on how I think this could best work without revamping the entire program.
So to simplify, it sounds like what you're suggesting, and I'm pretty amenable to this, is requiring an inspection between tenants or every 2 years or whatever, whichever is less.
I was going to say 12 months, but yes.
Or every 12 months, whichever is less.
At the same price, I wasn't going to increase the price. I mean, if the tenants live there, they're happy. We haven't gotten calls. We still do a 1-12-month review for $20.
Mm-hmm. May I ask a question, Mayor? May I ask a question? At what percentage do you think the city's running with inspections right now with the apartments that we know of?
I would say over 80%, if not 90%.
Mm-hmm.
Apartments for sure. Mm-hmm. It's the houses that are rented. Those are the ones that I think are the most that are falling through the cracks versus the apartment complexes, because we have a working relationship with every apartment complex. It's when now there's a small handful that change hands, and it's making sure the new owners, mm-hmm. if they are not local, they're not used to our system. There's four of them that went up for sale on Taylor Avenue since Christmas, because they weren't for sale when I did my sweep, and now they're all for sale, four of them. But we know that owner and that managing company right now,
mm-hmm.
but when it changes hands, I don't know who it's going to be. We have a good rapport with the current commercial buildings, apartment buildings now. We have a list of the homes, but I'm sure those are far less,
mm-hmm.
especially with the foreclosures and those that are trying to decide, I don't want to lose it, so I'm just going to rent it,
mm-hmm.
and not think twice about it. Not think twice about calling us either, unfortunately. But we get a lot of phone calls from citizens saying, hey, there's a rent sign went up on my neighbor. Have you inspected it? We get that call a lot, and we'll then inspect it or contact them and make sure.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, with the stickers, people can kind of just know,
they know that
and see. So it sounds like you all have this in hand, and if stickers wouldn't even require an ordinance change necessarily, would it?
I mean, no, that's just a policy procedure and finding it in my current budget and then adding it to my proposed budget. But yes, it's not a huge cost, but yes.
The possibility of requiring stickers and annual inspections, is that something that Robbie Engel's going to, that's something that Robbie Engel's going to be discussing with the Landlords Association tomorrow?
I'm hoping to, yes. That should follow up, yes. And then it would be a ordinance that I'd be preparing, more so than not, and providing it to you all.
Commissioner May wants to.
I just had a question. I was looking when we were talking about when Mr. Mueller mentioned the Landlord Tenant Act. So I looked at it real quick on my iPhone here. So I looked at KRS 383.500, which says Landlord and Tenant Act. And it says local governments may enact provisions of that act. I mean, it's in place, so people are protected, but it says also if you want to do it at the local level, we can do it, but it had a requirement. I guess this is a question for the solicitor, since I'm not an attorney, just interpreting, where it says that local governments may do that, but they have to enact the ordinance in its entirety, and it listed the provisions as 383.505 to 383.705, which listed out the various sections of that act.
I'd have to review that, to check
to see if it meant that we had, I guess my question, does that limit us if it says that we're going to, if a local government wants to enact those provisions of the Landlord-Tenant Act, or I guess that's my question, would that tie our hands in any way?
I'd be surprised if you have to enact the whole thing, but that one thing you might remember, and I think Gary sort of touched on that, there used to be a separation between first-class cities and other cities. Mm-hmm. There was a separate Landlord-Tenant Act, and I haven't looked at it lately, but as you might imagine, the first-class cities had a much stricter act. It was more complicated and more expensive to enforce. But it sounds like you're looking at this from a public safety perspective. The purpose of this is to protect tenants from unsafe conditions.
Correct.
And I think you certainly can pick out those provisions you think are significant and enact them. But I'd be glad to look into this or have Rob look into this question of how much, whether you have to enact that whole section.
Because okay, I was looking at one of the sections did talk about how if a tenant were to complain or notify the city of problems, that it says like a tenant cannot retaliate against, I'm sorry, a landlord could not retaliate against a tenant. Mm-hmm. And that's listed in the statute. So I just wanted to be sure that if we wanted to do something as was suggested, we could do it without having to enact other parts of that statute that we may not necessarily like. But I certainly think
you could. And of course, this was pointed out earlier too, there are lots of state laws that apply to this sort of thing anyway that you can't control through the ordinance that supersede what you do. But none of those would be anything that Gary would not want in the ordinance, I don't think. If you wanted to enact a specific provision like you're talking about, if that is not statutory, if you have to enact it by ordinance, I think that anti-retaliation.
They're already protected then, right?
Yeah.
So we wouldn't even have to.
I don't think so, but again, that would be easy for me to check and find out.
I was just recently, while we were talking, I looked at it. I hadn't.
The other issue you all haven't talked about here is the cost of this, and I'm sure Gary wouldn't propose it if he didn't think that he had the staff to handle it, but it sounds like it would generate more time with your people and maybe more legal time in court as well.
We average 1,400 a year rental inspections. We had 1,383, I think, the year before, and this past year was 1,424, roughly. Doing the additional occupied ones or unoccupied ones that hadn't been inspected from 12 months period would be an increase. I don't have a good number on that right now, but it would be likely double. But it would be, we would do our best. Without it being on an annual basis, like 1 month, we have to do this for the whole city. it's easier to do it on a 12-month basis because then we can spread it out over the 12 months of the calendar year to make it work. So I would feel better about that.
And of course, the fees for those inspections aren't exorbitant or even particularly high, but they do, I mean, I assume they do help supplement the expense of the city a little bit.
Yes, we went from $10 to $20 last year
through
an ordinance. And, we don't charge very much,
yeah, mm-hmm.
but it works.
If we're settled on that, I've got one more subject that's relevant to Gary. It was talk of easing, I think a few of us brought this up, talk of easing restrictions on small businesses in residential neighborhoods, whether or not it be home businesses or, you know, even like corner stores or whatnot. I mean, I recognize we don't want, you know, large industries in the middle of South Frankfort or Rolling Acres or Indian Hills, but I mean, it seems that allowing for, you know, more home, home salons or you know, I mean, corner markets where people could walk to get milk and bread, et cetera, would be beneficial.
Mm-hmm.
What do we need to do to, but I also recognize this is a little more complex issue, so what do we need to do to walk down that road?
There's two methods, basically. One is the owner can request his own map amendment, which would change the zoning from a residential district to a more of a mixed-use district or a commercial limited professional office. That's in the books now. It's allowable now. The comp plan update we did in 2009 enforces that, encourages that. As far as out of your home, that would be an amendment to the home occupational section of our zoning code. I've already advised the several members of the zoning update committee that the city was looking at changing its beauty salon barbershops because right now that's prohibited. You can't ask, no ifs, ands, or buts. And from prior conversations, I understood we need to move in the direction that would be allowable. Still with limited, still with the review, but change the code that way. That's all I've heard as far as a specific use. What we allow today is offices, arts and crafts, and no other employees, and no customers coming to your home. Okay? And if it's a gray area or if it's questionable, I'm going to limit the size of how much of your home you can use. It's 10%, I believe, for single stories. If we want to expand that, the uses, then we would need to, it would help me if I could get some suggestions from you all that what you're looking for. Special Capital has our historic district. We've amended that within the last 2 to 3 years and added a lot more uses as far as non-typical residential uses. It even allows small restaurants in some of them, depending on what type of street you reside on. What we don't want to happen is high traffic based on customers or employees in streets that are not designed for higher traffic and not to cause the disturbance and out of character feel of a neighborhood to something else. Well, not everybody wants to live on Main Street or Louisville Road in a corridor commercial area, and we don't want to bring that into every neighborhood. But there are a lot of people that do a lot of internet business, selling, trading. They're supposed to have a business license. I know that is one thing that is falling through the cracks that is terrible to enforce, very hard to do. But a few have called, wanted to do the right thing, and they were at the extent where I couldn't approve it. And so it's a double-edged sword, and we don't want to penalize anyone for that. One, I know we were able to work their situation out. The other one just never called back, and I don't know. We never got another complaint. It didn't start from a complaint, so we haven't further investigated that one. But to be honest. But that's how I don't want it to be a burdensome, and I don't want folks to do the right thing and then be denied of something they've been doing for the last 10 years.